Former Senator Leila De Lima wants a probe into two former justice secretaries who placed prosecution witnesses against her in government's witness protection program. This comes after the Court of Appeals reversed two notices issued by the Office of the Ombudsman dismissing De Lima's 2018 complaint against former justice secretaries Vitaliano Aguirre and Minardo Guevara. For De Lima, Guevara should at least be made to answer the administrative aspect of the case and defend his role in propping up criminal convicts as state witnesses, even if they are disqualified from being granted immunity under the law. As for Guevara, he says he will wait for the ombudsman action and that he will be ready to respond once asked to. Let's get an update now on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Benison Estareja.
Good morning, Katrina, and to all our viewers. As of now, we're not seeing weather disturbance, whether low-pressure area or tropical cyclone forming within the Philippine area of responsibility until the end of November. We have the northeast monsoon or Amihan affecting northern Luzon as of today. Cloudy skies with light rains over Cagayan Valley, Apayao, Caninga, Mountain Province, and Ikugao, whereas partly cloudy to cloudy skies with some isolated light rains over Ilocos Region and the rest of Cordillera Region. For Metro Manila and the rest of the country, partly cloudy to cloudy skies today with some isolated rain showers or thunderstorms due to easterlies. Range of temperature for Metro Manila between 23 to 31 degrees Celsius, whereas for Baguio, 16 to 25 degrees Celsius. There's also gale warning raised over the seaboards, over the coast of Ilocos Norte, Batanes, and Cagayan, and the wave height could reach up to 4.5 meters, which means the sea travel suspension is possible over small sea vessels. That's the latest from PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. This is Benison Estareja reporting.
Thank you very much for that update, Benison. Heading now to China, where the country's health ministry urges local authorities to increase the number of fever clinics. This as China grapples with a surge in respiratory illness in its first winter since it eased over COVID restrictions. The spike became a global issue last week when the World Health Organization asked China for more information, citing a report on clusters of undiagnosed pneumonia in children. The WHO, meanwhile, says data provided by China suggested the recent cases were linked to the lifting of COVID curbs about a year ago. An infectious disease expert sounding the alarm over the situation in China, Dr. Ronjen Solante reminds the public to mask up and keep COVID and flu vaccinations up to date.
Hindi tayo magpapanik na baka sasabihin na naman natin another COVID or a novel pathogen, no, na hindi natin alam, no? But it's also important na while we are monitoring, mag-iingat din tayo dahil alam mo naman ang sakit ngayon, mabilis nang mag-travel between country to another country dahil nga sa wala nang restriction, no?
The Philippine Health Department earlier said it will keep tabs on the situation in China. It also advised Filipinos traveling to China to exercise minimum public health standards. Flood survivors in Somalia in urgent need of help as aid agencies warn of a possible outbreak of diseases. The death toll now at 96, while about 700,000 have been displaced. Like other countries in the Horn of Africa, Somalia has been battered by heavy rains since October. This has unleashed widespread flooding, triggering displacement and exacerbating an already existing humanitarian crisis caused by years of insurgency. One person is dead and 12 others are missing after a cargo ship sank off the Greek island of Lesbos. The Comoros flag raptured departed from Egypt Sunday and was bound for Istanbul when it reported a mechanical failure and issued a distress call. Eight of the crew are Egyptians and the rest are Syrian and Indian nationals. Only one has been rescued so far. The Israeli government set to provide freed Filipino hostage Jimmy Pacheco lifetime social security benefits and regular stipends. The benefits are similar to those given to Israelis who are victims of terrorist attacks. Israeli Foreign Minister Eli Cohen personally visited Pacheco at a hospital where he is recovering after 49 days of captivity in Gaza. Pacheco was among those released on the first day of the four-day truce. Meanwhile, a 60-year-old Filipino remains missing. The Philippine government believes Noralyn Babadilla may have also been abducted by Hamas militants.
Sana maging hostage yung tao, no? Pero the alternate kasi kung hindi hostage si yung isang Pilipina. By the way, she's a dual citizen, no? May Israeli citizenship. Kung hindi siya hostage, dalawa lang ang paliwanag niya. Nagtatago siya sa buhay ni Israel, ayaw niya magpakita. Or isa siya sa mga namatay. Kasi marami pang hindi ma-identify na bodies.
A 4-year-old Israeli-American girl also released from captivity on the third day of the truce between Israel and Hamas. Here's the full story.
Israeli-American toddler Abigail Eden was among 17 hostages that the militant group Hamas released Sunday.
Her mom was killed in front of her when her kibbutz was attacked by Hamas terrorists on October 7th. Abigail ran to her dad then, who then was gunned down as well, while using his body to shield little Abigail.
U.S. President Joe Biden shed light on the diplomatic efforts that have been at play to secure the Hamas-Israel temporary ceasefire.
We have been in close contact with the leaders of Qatar, Egypt, and Israel, speaking with each one of them repeatedly over the past few weeks to help secure this deal. The proof that this is working and worth pursuing further is in every smile and every grateful tear we see on the faces of those families who are finally getting back together again.
The road to recovery could be long, though.
Physically, many of them are doing okay. Emotionally and psychologically, this is going to take a long time to recover from. And Israel and other countries have mobilized substantial resources to be able to deal with that trauma as we go forward.
As part of the truce, dozens of Palestinian prisoners have also been freed. And fuel and humanitarian aid has been entering Gaza. But it's unclear if the ceasefire will hold or be extended.
When this ceasefire period ends, as Netanyahu has said, the conflict will continue. And that conflict will continue, as Israel has stated, until Hamas is removed.
There are hopes, however, that a permanent solution to the Israel-Hamas conflict can be eventually reached.
Until there is an independent Palestinian state, there is not going to be peace or security in that region.
From the Vatican, Pope Francis also underscored the importance of dialogue to resolve the conflict and celebrated the latest release of hostages. Veronica Valderas Iglesias, VOA News, Washington.
As the truce takes hold, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu meets with security forces inside the Gaza Strip. There, he reminded troops of Israel's goals to eliminate Hamas and to ensure the release of hundreds of hostages. He also told Israeli soldiers their offensive will continue once a 4-day ceasefire is over. But Netanyahu says he would welcome an extension of the truce if it means more hostages would be released. Over now to the Russia-Ukraine front. Moscow launched its largest drone attack on Kyiv yet since the start of its invasion. This report.
An air raid siren blares amid a Russian drone attack on the Ukrainian capital. The head of the capital city administration, Serhiy Popko, called it the most massive air attack by drones on Kyiv. Ukraine's Air Force said it shot down 74 of the 75 Iranian-made drones. The attack started Saturday, coming in waves for more than 6 hours and leaving 17,000 people without power in the region, according to Ukraine's energy ministry. It also came on the 90th anniversary of the Holodomor famine genocide. Holodomor, which means death by hunger or starvation, was a campaign through 1932 and 33 orchestrated by then-Soviet leader Joseph Stalin to seize control of Ukraine's grain production. At least 3.5 to 7 million Ukrainians died. According to the University of Minnesota, those numbers may be understated.
Caro Presidente Zelensky, caro Volodymyr.
It was against this backdrop that Italian Prime Minister Giorgia Meloni recorded a video message to Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky on Holodomor Memorial Day. She said her government welcomed Kyiv's resolve to continue the Grain from Ukraine humanitarian food program, announcing a further contribution of $2.2 million to the effort. As part of the program, Ukraine partnered with countries and private sector donors to supply its grain to countries in Africa and Asia that face malnutrition and hunger. At a recent meeting of the UN Security Council, Ukraine's permanent representative to the United Nations accused Moscow of again using similar tactics as those in the early 1930s.
Starvation is one of Russia's methods of warfare, has encompassed various components since day one of the full-scale invasion. These include blocking Ukrainian food exports, shelling Ukrainian ports and grain stores, mining Ukrainian fertile soils, and turning them into battlefields.
Following Russia's drone strikes, Zelensky and European leaders met in Kyiv at an international summit on food security. He said foreign partners would supply Ukraine with vessels to accompany and secure convoys of cargo ships from Ukraine's ports. Zelensky added his country hoped to solve air defense shortages through new supplies from partners and increasing Ukraine's own production capacity before another air raid siren cut short the joint news conference. At least five civilians in Kyiv were wounded in Russia's assault on the capital, with several buildings damaged from falling debris, including a kindergarten. Those injured include an 11-year-old child, according to Mayor Vitaly Klitschko. Arash Arabasadi, VOA News.